Hamilton, and I'm going to be your presenter today. So I want to thank you very much for joining us, and I hope you're going to enjoy the webinar. When we're done, I'm going to send you the slides, a copy of the slides, and if I'm lucky today, I'm going to be able to also send you a video. That may be a little later today. So we're going to get started. What I'd like to point out is that we have a couple ways that you can send me a note, whether you have more information on a subject or whatever. You can, if you open that little screen at the bottom, there's a white arrow and a little orange box right by the GoToMeeting. You can open that up, and that'll be your sidebar, and there's a chat screen on there. You can send a chat message to me. You could also hit, there's a little plus sign that has questions, says questions. You can click on that, and I will see what your question is. And if you want to ask a question while I'm talking, you can do that, and I can answer it right online here. Or the other thing you can do, nobody else will see your question except me. So the other thing you can do is you can write me a note for later and say, you know, call me next week, or have you checked this, or can I have a copy of the FBI briefing or something like that. Any of those are options that you can do. Somebody's held their hand up. Somebody said thanks. So that's how easy it is to send a question. And then, you know, you can hold your hand up, and probably I would see that and do that too. So let's go ahead and get started. And again, I encourage you to participate. If you have questions or want something explained, just feel free to ask. Another hand up. Donna, it goes down. Hi, Bob. How are you? Glad you could come. And Connie, of course, is one of my regulars. And so, you know, a lot of these people, some of them I've never even met in person, but they've become friends because they've come to my webinars, which I certainly appreciate. So we're going to be talking today about how to set up an active shooter program. And it's not just active shooter, as you'll see. It's active shooter, it's workplace violence, it's compliance, it's all these different things. And I'm just going to make sure you're getting a full screen here real quick. Just going to do one little adjustment. There we go. And put it back on full screen. There it goes. So, next slide. You can read about me when I send you the slides if you're interested. So what's in a name? What do they call it? Do they call it an active shooter? I've heard people now call it an active killer because the FBI just reestablished the definition for an active shooter. So now you can be an active shooter with a knife. You can be an active shooter with a machete. You can be an active shooter with a pencil and go around and stab people. And so that's why people have said, you know, make the name active killer instead of active shooter. But again, that's totally up to you because these are all the different pieces of it. You know, we have local terrorists that are being controlled or encouraged by ISIS overseas. We have workplace violence issues. We have domestic violence. I don't know if you saw yesterday that in Chesapeake, Virginia, they had a family of six killed by one of the family members, one of the brothers, shot to death, include the parents, the other brother, the wife, sister, and the grandma. They went down the street and shot the grandmother too, and then, of course, the guy killed himself. So these are all the different kinds of things that they classify, and what's interesting is when you read active shooter statistic, it only applies to active shooter. They're still using the old definition. So it doesn't apply to workplace violence. That's counted separately. Even if they kill somebody at work, it doesn't really count. And then domestic violence, something completely different. So that's when the guy, his wife tells him she wants a divorce, and so he walks up to the hospital the next day and kills the nurse at the shift change out while the security officers are standing there, and there's nothing they can do because in that particular hospital, which I came 2 weeks after it happened, the risk manager told me how proud she was of herself because she had taken away their batons, their pepper spray. She took away the tasers. You know, nobody had a gun. And, you know, so they killed this beautiful 25-year-old nurse with three little kids under five at home. Her husband came and did it at work. So doesn't count as active shooter, counts as domestic violence, not even workplace violence. So you're not really getting the full picture. When you see these statistics, they're really about three times higher than you think. So one of the things that I get excited by strange things. So I was excited when I saw this headline that this was December 16th of this year, and this is the FBI director finally admitting that Chattanooga shooting at the Naval Recruiting Station last July was a terror attack. like I knew that 15 minutes after it happened because the guy had jihadi stuff all over his Facebook page. You might want to try that next time you hear of an active shooter incident and you're near your computer. It takes them a couple, sometimes a whole day or more to take down somebody's Facebook page. So if you hear one of these incidents, you can go to their Facebook page and download their manifesto and read all the horrible things they've said. And so it always amazes me why HR can't figure out a way to look at these before they happen, because it says all over some people's Facebook page, I want to kill everybody at my office, I hate my boss, you know, I got 16 new guns yesterday, I've spent all day at the range, you know, and nobody sees that until after it happens. And everybody goes, oh, I had no idea. Yeah, well, it was all public information. It was all they had to do was look. So a lot of times I look and then you see some interesting things. So we need to learn how to live in a more dangerous world. Obviously, this is not the world that I grew up in. You know, I grew up in Southern California in a little suburban community and, you know, with a two-parent house, and everything was, you know, the worst thing that I think ever happened, or we ever did, me and my sister, was we went down to the gas station, you know, late at night when they were closing up and got cigarettes out of the cigarette machine. So that was my, you know, that's a terrible thing I did when I was younger. Now there's a whole bunch of more terrible things going on, and I mean, we shouldn't have even been down there by ourselves, but now people, we need to be situationally aware. We need to know where we are. It doesn't really matter if we're at work or we're at the mall or we're at our church. Wherever we are, you never know when one of these things is going to happen, just like the health department where all those people were killed. It wasn't workplace violence. It was just terrorism. And you have to learn how to be situationally aware, and that's something that you need to teach your employees if you want them to deal with active shooter. That's the first pillar, the first part of the active shooter program I'm going to show you, is being situationally aware. You can't stop an active shooter attack, and you can't stop a terrorist who's targeted you from attacking you, but there's a couple things you do. You can increase your probability of surviving the attack. And the other thing that you can do is you can present a front to anybody who walks by so that they know that, I'm just looking for something here for you. I'm looking for something, let's see, about 9/11, here we go, that, just lost my train of thought. So another thing about situational awareness, actually two points I want to make. One is, and later on in the presentation, it's going to talk about a 328-page study that NIST did, and what they did was they looked at evacuations during 9/11, and what they found was there's a direct correlation. The people who were closer to the place where the plane hit the building were less likely to get out. And the reason wasn't because there was smoke or fire or anything. It was because they froze in place. And what they said there was, the more you know, people know about these horrible things happening, the better off they're going to be if something happens to them, because they're going to recognize it and they're not going to freeze their brain. So a lot of these people, 20% of the people could have gotten out, didn't. They just died on the floor. They walked around in circles. So I have this book that somebody recommended, and I bought it and read it. It's called the Unthinkable, and there's a note about it, and I can tell you more about it if you want to buy it. It was $10 on Amazon. It's written by a woman named Amanda Ripley, and it's about who survives when disaster strikes and why. So it goes into all these things from this one woman who got out of 9/11, and she explains how she felt. They interviewed her for 2 years. They had to wait until she could even talk about it. But it turns out that your brain tries to protect you by actually changing things. So people were going up staircases when they should have been going down because their brain told them to do that. And she recounts a whole bunch of these things. One of them was the bodies. When she walked out, finally got out of going the wrong way on everything, and even when she finally got out, she couldn't get home. She went to all these train stations, took the wrong train, got home like 5 hours later because she couldn't remember, because her brain had stopped it. So one of the things she said was that she got out of the stairwell and she looked out. Her brain could not make sense of it. She said she'd traveled a long way from the 73rd floor to the ground. She had invented three different explanations for what happened. But each time she was forced to abandon it. First she thought it was an accident. And then people kept saying, well, it was deliberate, you know, because there were two at the same time. So she passed in and out bouts of rage as her brain worked to make sense of it, and denial slowed her down by distracting her with false hope, by saying, if you just go two floors up, it's going to be fine, even though it wasn't. And also those ideas that she had, her brain gave to her, helped to calm her down. And one of the things she really distinctly remembers is walking out on the plaza and seeing bodies laying around, except she didn't know they were bodies. Her brain actually changed them and interpreted them differently, gave them different shapes and different colors so they didn't look like people. So she came out and looked around and thought, like, what are all those strange shapes laying out on the plaza? And after looking at them for like half an hour, she realized they were bodies of people. But her brain changed her perception, and that's what happens to people when there is a traumatic incident like any of these things that we're going to be talking about. And that's why it's so important that they become aware, because the more they know about it, the more they have a chance of surviving it and making sure all their friends survive too. So this is just a little review I put together to say, okay, what are these active shooter incidents? You know, we had a very active shooter season over the summer between June and October, and then culminating with the, of course, with the San Bernardino shootings. And I know right where those happened. I used to live up in the mountains there in Forest Falls, drive through San Bernardino every single day on my way to work at University of California. And, you know, it was so shocking when that happened. But let's take a look at these other incidents and look at the age range. They're all, the youngest was 21, oldest was 59. They were all male. In fact, the only woman in any of these is the jihadi bride from San Bernardino. Look at their issues. First one was a racist. The second one was, I had put jihadi down here, and now that's proved that that's right. And but also angry. The guy in Lafayette, depressed. Workplace violence, grudge in Roanoke, Umpqua. That's the community college that had the shooter go in the lecture hall and shoot people. We'll be talking about more later because one of their main controls failed. It wouldn't have failed if they'd done the proper assessment ahead of time. And then, of course, the Planned Parenthood guy. And I think he was a little crazy. You know, when you see him and see his eyes, you just wonder how he is. I think they probably all had some kind of mental illness. And did they die? Well, the shooter, the youngest one, didn't. He turned himself into police after shooting 9 people in the head. In Chattanooga, the guy went through, shot 4 Marines and a petty officer, and as he walked out the back door, he reloaded to go back in, and that's when the Chattanooga sheriff's car pulled up, and they killed him. In Lafayette, the guy saw, in the theater shooting, the guy saw the people coming, the police coming, and shot himself. This was after all the shooting was over. In Roanoke, he got in a car, drove down the road, and killed himself in his car. In Umpqua, he killed himself again when the police started to arrive. And in Planned Parenthood, he turned himself in after killing a young police officer and injuring a lot of other policemen. So main thing I want you to get out of this slide is a response time, which is why we're having this webinar in the first place, is that the response time is too long. And it doesn't even matter how they try to shorten it up. They just can't get there in time. 15 minutes, 5 minutes, even at 5 minutes in every single one of these, all the shooting was over before the police arrived. Now, they did eventually arrive, and in a couple of cases they killed a guy, and maybe that prevented other casualties. But when you're going to have one of these incidents, this guy's going to walk through your lobby. He's going to be wearing plated armor. He's going to be carrying an AK-47, a rifle, a couple of handguns, and he thinks he looks great. One of the misperceptions is they think, oh, these people came through. They're going to come through the loading dock. They're going to sneak through a downstairs window. No, they're not. They're proud of themselves. They think they look wonderful. In fact, any day now, I expect them, the active shooter guy, to take hand his cell phone to the receptionist and have her take a picture of him, you know, because he thinks he looks so great with all his guns and everything. So you can see all the people killed. This is going to be a year, 2015, where it's way more than any other year. So these are some of the terrorist events that we look at: Paris, San Bernardino, Merced, where that was a stabbing, and the Umpqua College in Oregon. Now, this is what we find out later by reading their Facebook page and looking when their manifestos finally get sent out. Now, in Umpqua, I mentioned there was a problem there. I think the guy, his name was I forget what his name was. So something like Faisal Mohammed, something like that. And he shot all these people in a lecture hall. He asked them if they were Christian, and if they said yes, he said, "Great, we can go see Jesus now." Shot him in the head. And the other people who weren't Christian, he shot on the legs. But a lot of these sort of feed on each other. So you can see this just came out January 13th last week from Baton Rouge. Gunman responsible for the rampage in a Louisiana movie theater left a journal thanking the man who'd killed the 9 black people in church in a rambling handwritten 40-page journal released by the police Wednesday. Hauser described Dylan Roof as green but good. Had he reached political maturity, he would have seen that, you know, a bunch of other stuff. And he shot and killed 2 people, wounded 9 others before he killed himself. And in his journal, he actually had they did a 600-page investigation on him. And so he was like feeding off the other shooting. He said the state of the United States was a filth farm, and he hated the news media, national political figures, women, gays, and blacks. And he said America as a whole is now the enemy. So a lot of these people are motivated, and they sort of feed off each other. So this is the worst one of the year, of course, December 2nd, where we had 14 killed, 21 seriously injured, for a total of 35, and in my opinion, could have been completely prevented. The shooter was a Department of Health employee, and at the time they thought he had a workplace grudge, but he really didn't. He hadn't been fired or anything. He had some political discussions with another person, but that was it. He was a radical Muslim with a radical Saudi wife, and he was an experienced mark man, and his Facebook said his hobby was target shooting. And how could we have known that this was going to happen? Because this guy changed his clothes. He used to wear khakis and polo shirts to work, and all of a sudden his father said that 3 months ago he changed to Muslim religious clothing, white robes and a hat, and nobody noticed. Nobody reported it. Nobody called HR. Nobody said anything to anybody because it was politically incorrect. And so we have to quit doing that. If we see somebody having a big personality change, whether they're changing to Muslim religious garb or, you know, a Greek folk dancing costume, or if they just don't change their clothes for a week and they quit bathing, that should be reported to somebody. Not to get the person in trouble. They're already in trouble. We just want them to get to somebody who's going to help them, who can call in somebody. And so HR is the one, or if you have an employee assistance program, to write in or call and say, hey, something's wrong with this person. They've changed their personality in the last week. So after reading all these things and just getting sick, reading them all the details of them and how horrible they are, you know, I thought, okay, what could we do? What kind of a program could you set up to prevent this? And so being in risk assessment for years, this is a program I came up with. These are the 4 steps. So, you know, we have a program where we can come in and do this for you, or, again, you can do part of this yourself. So the first one is situational awareness, and that's the most important one. It helps people wake up to danger, and it helps them, again, whether they're sitting at their desk or whether they're walking out to their car at 5 o'clock in the middle of winter, and it's dark outside and they're aware of who's around them. They notice what's happening when they go to the mall. I even had my kids, when I lived in Long Beach, California, went to the mall to buy some sheets at JCPenney with 2 little boys who were 7 and 10, and there was a giant gang fight with gunshots and everything in the mall, right in the main part of the mall. And luckily they were playing the video games in that little gold mine concession, and the guy, you know, pulled down the steel controls, you know, and basically, you know, saved the children from getting hurt. And that was, you know, 20 years ago. So the first part is that situational awareness. Next is the active shooter assessment. So I believe there's no point having training unless you've assessed your risk already and made sure your controls are in place. And you'll see in Umpqua how the controls were not in place. So they thought they were and they weren't. Active shooter assessments. It's going to teach you and show you how likely you are to have an active shooter incident or a workplace violence incident or a domestic violence incident at work or a local terrorist incident. It also reduces corporate liability or your agency liability, because it shows that you've done everything humanly possible. You've evaluated, you've done an assessment based on real threat information, and you've reviewed all your controls recently. The best thing you can do to prevent some kind of a lawsuit And it also helps you prevent the incident from happening because you present a hardened target. And when people go to do this, they just don't do it, you know, especially if they're planning on doing something crazy. They don't want to get caught, or they don't want to get shot. So they're going to find a place that's easy to get in. So they want some place that has open access, which is unfortunately still 80% of the places I go, they have complete open access to everybody all the time. So we want to check that. We want to reduce it. Next, so that's the second, is the assessment part. The third is doing live training classes for everybody annually. So every one of your employees, I don't care if you have 27,000 employees, you know, they deserve to have 1 hour of active shooter situational awareness training once a year. I don't think that's too much to ask, or even every other year is better. So we do live training classes. Come to your location, do the training. We have three classes. One is for management, so they understand what the threat is. The second is for the general staff, and the third is for what I call the front-facing staff. So this is the 27-year-old receptionist, and you can see how great they are because I was at a hospital in Virginia last week, a week and a half ago, before the storm, and this young lady, was at the front desk. There were two people at the front desk. They have a panic alarm under the counter in the front desk reception area. And this guy wheeled himself into the hospital through the revolving door, through the automatic doors, came up and took a gun out of his pants and put it up on the counter. And everybody started screaming. They ran away. They freaked out. They didn't press the panic alarm to alert security. They didn't do anything. Didn't call 911. And it turned out that the guy didn't want to shoot anybody anyway. He was a disabled vet, and he just wanted to show them that he had a gun. He was trying to do the right thing and tell them he had a gun, and instead it terrified everybody. So they need to have the live training classes. I know people get computer-based training. They get CPI. They watch everybody's like, oh, did you see this video? The video is not enough. They watch videos all day on TV. You know, they have worse scenarios on TV than we could imagine. And it doesn't help them be situationally aware. They have to have live training, because if they're doing a computer-based training and everybody's in right security emergency management, so they get a call from somebody and they take the call. And maybe somebody's text, maybe it's their new boyfriend texting them. Maybe it's something else, you know. I mean, but that's what's happening. So they need to have a live training. They need to feel it. They need to be somewhere where somebody's watching them, you know, like me. So I'm not going to let them turn on their cell phones, right? And I'm also going to throw things at them and out of the audience, nothing that would hurt them, but I'll tell you later what that's going to be. When you're all done with those three steps, that's when you have a drill, and you decide if you're a hospital, a children's hospital, you only want to do a tabletop, that's fine, because doing a tabletop is hugely better than doing nothing. Maybe you can do a complete active shooter drill if you're a big federal agency. And you should. If you can, you should. Get the budget. And the other thing I've been seeing lately is a lot of these CEOs and administrators and things are walking down from their desk on the top floor and coming down to the emergency manager, security director, and saying, what are we doing about active shooter? Let's have a drill. And I've had three people in the last 2 weeks who want to start with a drill. And I said, I'm not going to do a drill for you unless you go through these other steps, because I know a lot of people who've done drills, and if they don't have the training and you haven't done the assessment, the drill gets you nowhere. It just makes people feel it frightens people. It makes them feel horrible because they don't know what to do and they're sure they're doing the wrong thing. So it turns out to be a very negative exercise. And that's why these small steps, situational awareness is just sending out these risk alert bulletins to people every week, posting them in the elevator, having stacks of them, you know, in the reception area in the waiting room. Those kind of things get people to start thinking about it. The assessment shows you where your weaknesses are and how likely you are to be a target. It reduces the liability. You have the training classes. Now you hold the drill, and now people are good, doing the right thing, and now it becomes a positive thing where they get rewarded for the knowledge that they've gained. So this is the pieces, again, in a piece of paper, but you'll see these when you get the slides. The awareness bulletins for situational awareness, and again, it tells them what's happening at other organizations just like yours. And even yesterday I had somebody tell me, I was talking to them, I guess it was day before yesterday in the car on the way home, and they're saying, yeah, but you know, our management doesn't want to talk about anything negative, and they don't want to have people aware of these other active shooter incidents. And that's horrible, because that you want them to know, because that's going to save their life. It's not going to help them. If it's possible to happen where you are, you need to tell them what's happened in other places, what's happened, you know, in other colleges, in other hospitals. They need to know this, and everyone has lessons learned on it, as you'll see. So it shows them, this is what we need to do if this happens. Then the assessment, then the training, and then the drills and exercises. So it's a whole comprehensive program, and it's based on what happened in all these other incidents. And there's a climate right now for fixing this. So I've also had a lot of CEOs call up and say, we want to do something right now. And they put together, they actually get the money from someplace else. It doesn't come out of the emergency budget, doesn't come out of the security budget. It comes out of a special emergency budget almost to get people trained so that we don't have this happen over and over again. So I apologize for people like, I know Bob's on the call, some other people I know that are very experienced and they know all this already. But this is sort of what we tell the average person who doesn't have that kind of experience, and we try to, in the training, try to teach people things that if they're not a professional, they can still implement it without having a lot of training. Again, the first part is situational awareness. The most important part of the program, I think, helps people, sets them up to be able to prevent and survive any violent incident, uses this risk alert program I have with the lessons learned, so they start reading it, and then something happens, they go, oh yeah, this is just like the Planned Parenthood went, oh yeah, this is just like what happened at Umpqua, oh yeah, this is just like what happened in Reno. And then the book that I was talking about that has all these different things in it, it's called The Unthinkable, Who Survives When Disaster Strikes and Why, author's Amanda Ripley. It's a great book, and I use it in part of my training, and you could, I think it'd be a great read for anybody who wanted to be on this call. So here's what a risk alert looks like. So I send these out, you know, to people all the time. And so if you are getting this part of the program, that means that when I send something to you, you have the right to send it out to all your employees, 3,000 employees, no problem, 5,000 employees, no problem. You send it out electronically to them. It's posted on the network, so it always stays there. This is the one in the broadcast journalist in Roanoke, Virginia. Now, this guy also had a very interesting Facebook page. He had his manifesto on there about how he'd been held back his whole life. He also, it said in his 26-page manifesto that he gave to ABC News, he intended to start a race war by killing two white people as payback for the murders in Charleston. So that just shows you how that Charleston thing reverberated with different results. Incident again, it began with the two journalists filming, you know, near Roanoke, Virginia, and he just came and shot them. He live tweeted the whole thing, what he was going to do, that he did it. Then he recorded it on his GoPro camera, and then he went down the road and killed himself. He felt like he'd been discriminated against, passed over promotion because of his race, all those things. And again, lessons learned. In most active shooter incidents, there's a background of mental illness in the shooter. Screenings to identify this employees up front allows them to get help and avoid paranoid feelings that they may act on. A lot of these people are taking psychotropic medications that say on the label that, you know, that they should, that they may cause aggressive action, that they may cause altered states, that they may lead to suicide, and nobody reads that. They take it anyway. The other thing, make other employees aware of the risk from employees who are fired for cause. And we had another one up in Philadelphia in the cracker factory up there, Kraft Cracker Factory in downtown Philadelphia, where they fired a lady for cause. She went out to her car and got her Glock gun and came back through another entrance because security did not notify the other people in the manufacturing plant of what was happening. And so they just let her back in, and she went right back in and shot and killed the two people who had fired her, and then she permanently disabled a third person who she saw. And never should have happened. In that case, it was contract security guards, and they went and ran in the boiler room and locked themselves in the boiler room. They did not call 911. They did not alert other people in the organization. And the judge awarded the families $46 million. Because they said, if you're going to be in security and call yourself a security guard, you actually have to protect people. You can't go hide in the boiler room when somebody comes in with a gun. So these are, I mean, you can't make this stuff up, I guess I'll say. And so these are the kind of things we want people to read so they see what, you know, they see what could happen. That's the whole point of this. So let me just go to my next slide. This is a complete opposite. This is a middle-aged shooter in the hospital, Brigham and Women's Hospital, who thought that they were not safe because they'd done a drill. They started with the active shooter drill, a complete drill. Did nothing for them because they had no training. They didn't do an assessment, so they didn't have any controls in place. They had no metal scanners. They had no weapon signage, nothing. And so what happened, you know, this is 8 days, 1 year and 8 days ago, there's this guy who's, the doctor had operated on his mother in October, and his poor mother died, and he was really, really angry about it, so he walked up with his big coat. Of course, he didn't have to take his coat off. He didn't even, they didn't have a handheld, you know, metal scanner to go over him, and there was no metal platform. So he just told me he wanted to see the doctor. They said, go on down the hall. He went down the hall, took out his gun, shot the doctor, and he died a couple hours later. And they had no weapon signage there. And you go like asking me, well, what difference would that make? You know, if you have a crazy shooter, he's not going to respond to no weapon signage. Yeah, but look at this guy. This is one of my baby boomer shooters, over 55, had a beautiful house. His family thought he was handling his mother's death really well, had four kids, had a great job. He had all these things, and he was an upstanding citizen. So sometimes an upstanding citizen can see a sign like that and think, gee, maybe they have some kind of surveillance farther down the hall. You know, maybe if I walk through this door, these alarm bells are going to go off, so maybe this is not a good idea. I should go put my gun back in the car. So that's another, you know, just something else to think about is they have, if you have no controls in place and people can walk in with a gun and shoot people, you know, that sort of says it all. I mean, A's for access control. You have to have some kind of access control. I understand everybody wants to be open, but there's a limit. I also think that even though you don't want to have a full access control system where everybody has to get badged and all these things, you know, and go through a computer screening or leave their license behind at the front desk, the least that you can have is a logbook where they have to sign in, looks official. They get a paper badge that you give to them, maybe on the self-expiring badge that, you know, is good for one day, and you take the time to have somebody go through, sign their name, and get a badge. Take the coat off. You pick up the coat. You see if it's heavy because it has guns in the pocket. You know, but even that small amount of improvement is going to make a difference because people, if they're going to go do this, they don't want to get screened. So they're going to look. They're going to drive by the place. They're going to case the joint. They're going to look at it and see, is this something, you know, I mean, do I have a chance of getting caught here? Because they want to take care of themselves. So that's just another example. Then we have our San Bernardino shootings. And again, what could they have done to do this? You know, recently changed his clothes to Islamic clothing, that definite, you know, Facebook page. They had 6,000 rounds of ammo with them. And, you know, it was a horrible thing. And this guy wasn't somebody you'd think would do that because he was an environmental engineer. I mean, he went out on site and did water quality tests. So, and it was the worst terrorist event in the U.S. since 9/11. Of course, his neighbor, you know, who was married to, they were related by marriage. He provided him with the ammunition. He bought him the guns. And it's the thing about this is what sort of brought this home to everybody is that, you know, ISIS has already been laying the groundwork for all these attacks. That's why we've had so many of them lately. And they're still in the pipeline. So these people just will get a call and be mobilized and come out and stab somebody or shoot somebody or do something. And so people need to be aware that that's possible so that they can protect themselves. So what do we learn from this? We learned that should report employees who make radical changes in dress, manner, anything else, isolate them, reduce their access until you know more. Access control systems need to get put in place to some extent, even if it's not an electronic system. Of course, I would prefer you get an electronic system, but, you know, can only do what you can do. Government agencies especially have to have a mass notification system because we're going to talk about a case that had so much confusion and lack of information, even from the people who were right there. And no matter what your organization is, if it's a great organization, it still can be attacked. So if you're in, you know, you're saving feral cats, for example, and that's your mission in life, you can still get attacked because these people don't care what kind of organization you have. You know, you're just somebody, you're vermin to be exterminated as far as they're concerned. They don't care, ISIS doesn't care about high-profile targets like 9/11. They don't care about where this happens, a city, county, they don't care. So, you know, and police are not going to show up in time, so you're on your own. That's why you need to do the second part of this, which is a risk assessment. This is also a service we do for you, very inexpensively, I might add, because we use tools to do it. Reduces liability directly, because it's a requirement. It meets compliance requirements, including all the healthcare ones from FEMA and DHS, IAHSS, the guidelines for hospital and healthcare security. CMS, Centers for Medicaid and Medicare, require it. Joint Commission requires it. OSHA requires it. And the new OSHA 3148 that just came out in April, less than a year ago, it also requires it. So we're going to just look at UMCO and see what happened there in that community college. They didn't, the first day, we had nothing. We knew nothing about that shooter. This was October 1st. So by October 2nd, we still knew nothing about him. We didn't know how many victims there were. As it was unfolding, I was watching it on Twitter. You couldn't tell how many people had been shot, and I found out later why. He shot the Christian, killed the Christians, shot the other people in their legs, came in with his bullet-plated armor, two handguns, a long gun, and AK-47. Now we know he had Asperger's syndrome. He had written a 20-plus page manifesto that the sheriff, the local sheriff, still hasn't released. For some reason, and I'm sure it's because it's going to turn out that they're going to reclassify this now as a terrorist incident. He tried to go to Syria. He had searched jihadi websites. He was taking psychotropic drugs, and he was in that room. And what happened, because their mass notification system completely failed, it was supposed to alert everybody. It was supposed to send an email to everybody on the list of the whole college, you know, faculty, staff, students. It was supposed to send a scrolling banner across the computer screen, and it was supposed to send them a text. It did none of those things. And this is from the IT professor there. He had his campus computer on. He was working on his computer at the time. There was no banner. He had his cell phone sitting next to him turned on. There was no text message, and there was no email. So the emergency notification system, which I found out what it was, called Blackboard Connect, it didn't work. And that's a horrible thing to happen, because people were getting these incidental reports on Twitter saying something had happened and some people were shot, and it went up. They were saying 30 people, 50 people, 60 people, 10 people. Nobody knew. People had dropped off their kids and were leaving. The local news picked it up and published it. So now everybody's going to turn around and come back. People continued to walk into the lecture hall and get shot because they weren't alerted that there was an active shooter incident going on. And, you know, if they had a PA system, they could have called it as a code, or they could have said active shooter event in life sciences building or something, you know, but none of that happened because the mass notification system failed. So the other thing, we'll talk about the risk assessment a little, but basically, the old law enforcement models, which came out 150 years ago, do not match what we're experiencing right now. They don't look at the threats the same way. The risk assessments are so important because they're required by all these different agencies, and they've been used by the Defense Department and the federal government since 1998. And the models self-adjust based on the change in the threat environment. And it's required almost everywhere now, these physical security facility assessments. Also, because of the rise of ISIS, and terrorism is not a low, because of the internet, like I said at the beginning, you know, I feel like I know some of these people, like Bob, who's on the call, because I've talked to them on the phone, they've come to my webinars, but I don't really know who they are. You know, I mean, they could be an ISIS operative for all I know, because it's all coming through the internet. We also have the crazy baby boomers who are over 55, and they end up in the emergency rooms, which can't handle them because they don't have enough beds. There's no place to put them. They got Alzheimer's. They're all by themselves in a big house, so they got lots of money. I saw one old lady in a hospital up in Northern California where she'd been eating the wallpaper off her dining room walls because she couldn't remember how to go to the store. Of course, family's gone, all moved on. She's there by herself, you know, with advanced Alzheimer's. And so it's just really sad that there's nothing to do with these people. And so, of course, you know, all this bad behavior is going to come out. FBI has also noticed all of the above, and so they came out with it a year ago. They analyzed events between 2000 and 2013, and that's where they redefined what an active shooter is. They said it's an individual engaged in killing or attempting to kill people in a confined or populated area. In most cases, they use firearms, but they said sometimes they use a knife, sometimes they use a machete, and those still can be classified as active shooter events. and you can see the timeline going up and how many incidents they had. Well, this year it's going to double that 26 number. It's going to be up to like 50 incidents in 2015. They also did some research and found out that it doesn't matter if you're a red or blue state. If you allow guns, don't allow guns, open carry, not open carry, doesn't matter. Same statistics in the 160 incidents that they looked at. Again, 486 killed, 557 wounded, and 80%. And remember, this ended in 2013. By now, it's 90% of the incidents. It was over before law enforcement arrived. That's why emergency preparedness and response are so critical. That's why the Emergency Response Department has been tasked now, not just with looking at tornadoes and hurricanes and all these preparedness plans, but actually having to come up with a plan for active shooter, because everybody in government knows this is going to be over before law enforcement. You can't dial 911 and get there fast enough. Even in campuses where the police are on the corner and you can see them out of your third floor window, they can't get there fast enough to stop the shooter. That's why we have to prepare these people so that they know what to do and hopefully prevent it from happening in the first place. Third part's the training. So again, I told you I don't think much of computer-based training. I think it's great as a maybe every other year thing, but they definitely need to have training. One of the other things I found is that people, you ask them, have you had security or active shooter training? They go, oh yeah, we had orientation when I first came to the company. How long ago was that? 17 years, 15 years, 19 years, and they've never had another security training class, only the orientation they got 20 years ago. So that's why they need to have a life training. So here's some of the things that we talk about in the training. Do they want to carry a gun? If so, what kind of a gun should they carry? They have to have something that fits them. They have to practice how to use it. They have to be able to carry it without being seen. They have to have the right permits. Because if one of these people sees you and you have a gun and you're the only one with a gun, you're the first person they're going to shoot, because they don't want you to use a gun, so they're just going to kill you right away. Now, this is another, what could the Oregon militant group up in, that we've been seeing on the news, what could they not live without? Well, they had three requests 2 weeks ago. First, they needed scatter rugs, because their feet were getting cold, I guess. Second, they needed creamer for their militia coffee, I guess, because they couldn't drink their, these big tough guys couldn't drink their coffee without creamer. And the third thing they wanted is tampons. So tampons can be your secret weapon, even if you're a big gut militant. So these are some little OB tampons that I picked up in a box at the store. And what's so good about them, don't think of about them as a tampon. Think of them as a sterile, compressed piece of cotton. And that means if somebody gets shot around you, you can use that to soak the blood up, staunch the wound. It also actually applies pressure to the wound, so it stops the bleeding. So I give these out. I give them out during the training. I keep them in my purse, and they're actually a very useful tool to have, along with the quick clot bandages that you can get and keep in your briefcase and use. So I would always keep some of these and some of the quick clot bandages in your purse. Run, hide, fight. People talk about run, hide, fight all the time, and they never talk about run. They all talk about where to hide and how to fight and how to do barricades, and that's all very interesting, but the most important thing is to run. Again, if you get out, you have a much better chance of surviving the attack. This is one of my problems with law enforcement. The way it's done now is that they want to come in and lock down the building. That's what they've been trained. It's not their fault. They've been trained that way for 30 years, come and lock down the building so that they can find the perpetrator, because that's what they want to do. What I want to do is the opposite. I want to open the building up. So if they come in the front, I want them to run out the back. I'm on the right side, I want them to run out the left side. Almost everybody knows how to evacuate, but we need to refresh their training on that. Nothing good is going to come if you have a violent situation, somebody walking around with a gun, if you're still in the building. That's what happened at the Navy Yard, too. They closed the Navy Yard, they locked the building down, and more people got shot. Same thing in Sandy Hook. They locked it down immediately. They thought they were doing the right thing. They weren't, because what happened is the guy just went from room to room in the classroom. One bullet opens the door, goes in, shoots 15 children, 5-year-olds, goes into the next one, shoots the door open, and they're all sitting there like little sitting ducks, shoots them all. So we want to emphasize the run in the run, hide, fight. Also, we want, even if we're there and we're in that situation, we want to keep running and moving up and down, because a moving target's really, turns out, it's not a cliche, it's a truth. A moving target's a lot harder to hit. Don't lock down and don't count on help from law enforcement. You have to be able to carry on yourself. Be a small target. So let's say you do get caught someplace. You want to be on the floor. You want to be high up. You want to be as small as possible. You need to find something to hide behind. And people don't know what those things are. Many people think that you can stand behind a wall and it's going to protect you. And drywall, bullet goes right through drywall. When I was in college in Southern California, I had some people have a fight in the parking lot and shoot a bullet, you know, and it went right through the wall to my apartment and lodged underneath my dresser door. I still have the bullet. So, you know, there are very few things that stop a bullet. Maybe if you're in a concrete block room, maybe that would stop a bullet. But people have to know these things so they're prepared and they don't think that they're getting away when they're not. Again, the barricading in the room where you want to be high or low because they're going to be shooting through the wall and the door. The bottom picture is from Chattanooga. You can see all the bullet holes there where he modified his car so he could shoot people and into buildings without even getting out of the car. So because people tend to fire at the waist area, being low or high reduces the risk. Then we talk about what you should carry with you, the gunshot wounds, the tampons. Not only does it make you prepared or make you feel prepared, but if you can help somebody else who's there, it calms other people down to see that you know what you're doing. So in this environment, I think what we need to do is take massive action to energize security. I'll give you one example of that, and that is I'm delivering an active shooter policy to somebody this afternoon that I just rewrote for them on workplace violence and active shooter. And what we're going to do is not going to do the old thing of you send out an email and say, hi, I'm the security director, and this is our new active shooter policy. Please read it. It's available on the network. Not enough. What you want to do is say, here's our new active shooter policy. You have to download it. You have to print it. You have to sign it and date it, and you have to take it and turn it into HR where it's going in your file. Just the fact of saying that increases the retention. Your brain physically shifts from one state to another, and it's 5 times more likely you're going to remember what you read if there's something action that has to be taken at the end. Those things cost nothing, but they make a huge difference. So one of the problems is because FEMA came out and said, okay, now active shooter is not in security or HR anymore, now it's in emergency management. So all these pieces of these programs are in different places, and they're in different departments in organizations. And so they're looked at as a random series of things that happen, starting with a drill, instead of looking at it as a total program. That's why I felt I had to put a program together that people could use so that they prevent this. And also, again, too much dependence on watching videos or online training. Staff members get security training only during orientation. So, you know, on your way home or out of the office today, you just think for a minute about how your organization would respond. The people that you know, what would they do if something like this happened? And down here on the bottom in yellow is a study that came out of 9/11 that talks about, you know, talks about the evacuations and why people didn't get out. If they have prior, in this research, they said people respond better in emergencies. If they have prior knowledge and exposure to that type of disaster, they're less likely to freeze in place. So that's the whole point of the situational awareness. So I wanted an active shooter program that we could present to people for very little money. I realized right away that one size does not fit all, but all staff need to have some kind of basic training at least annually. You can use the videos or the computer-based training you already bought for mid-year refresher training or alternate year refresher training, but really you need to have the whole program. You need to have the situational awareness, you need to have the bulletins, and at the end you need to have the drills. It also meets all these different compliance requirements, which is a new OSHA 3148 that came out in April, and it applies to everyone. The new CMS requirement that is for all healthcare organizations, even if you're a retail company and you sell wheelchairs, if you want to be reimbursed by the Centers for Medicaid and Medicare for the purchases, you have to have this kind of a security risk assessment done. Then we have the new FEMA operational requirements, again requiring risk assessments on every facility, and of course the Joint Commission for Hospitals that also requires these. So these are sort of the steps. You can review them later. These are the control elements. So we go through 73 for a hospital, 62 for any other facility, and we look to make sure these controls are in place, working like their communication system didn't work, and that the staff knows how to use them, knows where they are. And then we can also structure it by how much we need. So if you're in the middle column there, a large organization, you can do the awareness program, a risk assessment, have one management training class, six classes for the staff with 100 to 150 people in each class. And then the people who are the front-facing staff, we teach them a little differently, including how to de-escalate situations. And then we have, in this case, they're doing two tabletop drills and one big active shooter drill. And then the next column is a smaller college or medical center, where they're doing awareness, they're doing the active shooter assessment, they're doing the one main management class and two classes covers their staff, and they're doing one tabletop drill. So you can expand, you know, what you get out of it, and you can also expand it time-wise. So some people, this is based on an annual. So we're going to start with awareness, then we're going to have from April to June, we're going to do our training classes. In July to September, we're going to revisit and adjust our risk assessment. In October through December, we're going to have our drill. But lately, people say, well, I don't want to wait a year. I want to do this in 6 months. Okay, so you just compress the time frame, do it in 6 months. Somebody else says, no matter what I did, I couldn't get the budget until next year. So you can spread it out to a two-year time frame. So it's very adjustable, the pieces of it. But we just want it to go in sequence so you don't start with a drill and neglect everything else. So again, we review all the controls. It's a quantitative assessment, so we actually look at the percentage of implementation on each of these controls. We're able to calculate a return on investment at the end and write a report that shows you what you need to do, how much it's going to cost you, how much it's going to liability reduction is going to be, how much it's going to prevent a threat from occurring by return on investment. Basically, for every dollar you spend, you're going to save $1,000 or save $3,000 by preventing this event from happening in the first place. And we collect all this data, including surveying and interview using web surveys for people, but also we do interviews with different people. And then we involve the whole staff in this, and we find out what all the weaknesses are. Every time I do this, I've got a line outside the little office I'm using for people to come in and tell me all the horrible things that happened. You know, they had one Monday, I guess, they told me about the court reporter who was taken to, who was there just recording a deposition being taken and by a woman who was divorcing her husband, and the husband came in with a gun, shot twice, missed his wife, and killed the court reporter. And apparently that happens quite often. So this is how you find out all these things. And people they're very interested in this right now, so they'll be very happy to discuss it with you. Even all management is interested in this right now. And so sometimes I end up spending twice as much time someplace because everybody wants to come and tell me what happened in the past and what in management what their concerns are, because they have a lot of concerns. Nobody wants to get shot. So once you do this, then you can show people how compliant your staff is exactly with the OSHA requirement 3148, with a CMS requirement, with a DHS or FEMA requirement. Exactly how much are 76% compliance, which is exceptional, 14% non-compliant, 9% partial compliance. And then we put in all the numbers for all the threat numbers that come from your incident reports that I hope you're getting, government data that we have, incident data, Crimecast data, Uniform Crime Index. All these things are combined to see how likely these things are to occur the way it is now and where you're located. And then we go through all the controls. And not only do we look at their implementation rate, but we also look at the cost for implementing them to 100%. And that's also another data point for evaluating return on investment to see what do you need. You need a better security staff. You're short-staffed. It's going to affect every single thing you do, and it's going to be the best return on investment is to get one more person so you don't have the cameras not monitored at noon because the officer's out, you know, having lunch. So put all this together, have all these spreadsheets for auditors to look at that show exactly what's happened, and so that if somebody says, we always do this, it turns green. If they say, we never do it, it turns red. That means you can go through 60 pages and just pick out the things that aren't being done right now and review them. Easy to print reports with graphs attached to them. And then, so that's the whole solution here. We have our situational awareness, we have our risk assessment, we have the training, and then we have the drills. And I'm sure that all these kind of events are going to continue. And so you need a program, not just pieces of not just elements all by themselves. You know, and you can accomplish this in a health and safety committee. You can put your own committee, active shooter, workplace violence prevention committee together. And then you can, you know, help start to prevent these incidents, protect people, protect them with knowledge and training, meets all the compliance requirements, reduces your liability, and allows you to start taking massive action, making your staff situationally aware, designing more effective security controls, and instead of just doing controls that are nice to have, you're doing, making changes and putting controls in the right area where they're needed and also in the right amounts. So we also do workshops all over. I was supposed to do a workshop this week in Richmond, but I got snowed out, so they've changed it to April. So if you're in Richmond in April, come and meet me. We're also going to be at the IAHSS conference in North Carolina, I think it is, and would love to speak at your next event if you're having one. And they have some people I've already talked to are having one in Iowa after the caucuses are over. So would also be happy to come to your location, speak to your staff if you'd like. You can call me, email me, write me, my phone number, my email address, and be glad to talk about your program or what you'd like to do. And I want to thank you very much for being on our webinar today. And again, if you have any questions, you can leave it on that question box or you can get in touch with me. And I'd be able to send you the slides shortly and probably the video later on today. But again, thanks a lot. It was great to see Bob and some of my other friends on the webinar, and I hope I'll see you in the future too.